Hello, everybody. I am the Spearman, the Embracer of Human Good, and Analyst of Fiction, and welcome to the first vlog of the Tangled series vlogs, or should I say Rapunzel's Tangled Adventure series, as it's been known since the second season had premiered. And we're going to start today with none other than the pilot movie that started it all back in, I believe, March of 2017, Tangled Before Ever After. Obviously playing on the short film's title, Tangled Ever After, way back in 2012, back when they thought that's all they could do to extend the franchise in particular, as opposed to having Rapunzel or Eugene Flynn Rider appear in other stuff. But, just a quick backstory. I don't know too much about how this all began. I think the show was first announced back in spring of 2016 or spring of 2015, and I was really looking forward to it, though very concerned and confused when I first saw the images of a long-haired Rapunzel, blonde Rapunzel, you know? I'm like, what happened? Why the hell is her hair back? And this is supposed to be before the marriage, right? Is this supposed to be some sort of alternate universe or some stuff like that? But thankfully it's not, and what they do here, especially with the very first opening story of this series, well, proves that. So I'm going to try to be as concise as I can with this. I'm going to be even more concise with episodes, with the episodes of the show individually and in future vlogs. But here I'm going to try to be as extensive as necessary. I'm sure I won't go on too long. So, here we go. So, Tangled Before Ever After, the very first thing we see is a bunch of nice painting-like scenarios, narrated first by Eugene, then Rapunzel, with a bit of the chameleon Pascal laughing in the background. And it's a very good recap of what happened in the movie, you know, with the sun drop from the heavens, the golden flower, Gothel, Rapunzel and Eugene meeting for the first time, Gothel being killed, Eugene being saved after the world's most overdramatic haircut. I love that line. Then Rapunzel explains to us that this story starts about 6 months after the events of the film. I would have gone a bit longer. I probably would have made it at least a year, year and a half. But that's for me because I'm so tired of all these short time intervals when it comes to these franchises in general, especially franchises aimed for kids or family-friendly audiences, whatever. And, obviously Rapunzel has short hair, short brunette hair. She's just totally herself and just totally adjusting to life as a soon-to-be crowned princess, because that's how coronations work, especially under these circumstances, because she had been kidnapped and raised elsewhere for 18 long years. They have this really nice opening song called Life After Happily Ever After, which I'll play a little bit here because it's really, really nice. Yeah, and I think it's written by Alan Menken. I think every song in this show has been written by Alan Menken, you know, the Disney legend, been a Disney legend since the 90s, since the Disney Renaissance, probably since The Little Mermaid. And, we see how Rapunzel's really loving her royal life in the castle, trying to remember everyone's names, becoming close friends with the guard of Princess Duty, Cassandra. She's a special character, you'll see why in later videos. She's getting along well with her parents, especially her father, because he's the king and all, and I guess we don't get enough of royal dad and royal daughter's scenarios, do we? No, if you want a royal mother and royal daughter relationship, you might as well go see Brave, really good film. And we also see that Eugene is preparing to propose to Rapunzel on the night of the coronation, or before the coronation, for like a royal dinner get-together of other royals from other allied kingdoms. even though supposedly this is supposed to take place on Earth, per se, since they have a globe that literally looks like the Earth we know and love. I won't go too long on any nitpicks here, even with the pilot movie itself. Let's see here. So as the invitations are going around the kingdom, we see a rat take one of the invitations to his creepy looking master, who serves an even more mysterious mistress, I should say, named Lady Kane, who we don't see yet. She just sees the invitation and says, "It's time to pay our respects to our dear royals." Clearly, as shown here, and as was shown in the commercials at the time, she was supposed to be the big bad guy of the movie, at least. Rapunzel goes out about the town with like 10 or 15 royal guards, like, protecting her from being poisoned by cupcakes or being hurt by anybody, any of the people of the Corona. Yeah, that's right, the Kingdom of Corona, because unlike the movie, we actually know what the kingdom is called in this show, which is great. You know, Corona is a great name for it and all. And they even make that official in Kingdom Hearts and the Kingdom Hearts games. And Rapunzel has very mixed feelings about having a lot of guards on her at all times. One of the guards even, like does the hair of a girl, does her pigtails or something, which really annoys Rapunzel, who's just sitting next to him, all buzzed out. Like, wow, the king is really that desperate to protect her. And Rapunzel basically can't take it, you know. She's already had mixed feelings about staying in the castle all the time and barely getting to see any of the kingdom for the past 6 months. And now she can't go anywhere without a platoon of guards at her side, so she confides with Cassandra a bit about this. I can't remember if she confides in her mother, Ariana. That's right, the queen is Ariana, and the king is Frederick. A very special King Frederick he is. And Cassandra, almost immediately after Rapunzel confides in her, Cassandra says, "Hey, I can get you out of here and back, and nobody will ever know you were gone." That's going to be especially ironic considering what happens later. Rapunzel reluctantly agrees, and they make a little improvised plan to sneak out. It's at the pre-coronation event where Rapunzel meets all these royals from afar. She gives one, this duchess, a bear hug. It's really cute. And, you know, Frederick has to tell her, "No bear hugs, honey, please." And she makes a fun little tease at this one general from another kingdom. And, you know, he doesn't take lightly to it. And then we have this woman who is the Duchess of Queentonia. Queentonia, that should be a bit of an elephant. If there ever was one, as to who this character is. I really wish I would have called it out when I first saw it back in 2017. And then at the dinner, at the royal dinner, Eugene makes his proposal, and at first Rapunzel is really taken aback by it. But when Eugene kind of says the wrong words accidentally, like, "I can't wait to grow very, very old here and raise our children's here," Rapunzel's big smile goes down, and she's like, "Here? In this castle? Forever?" And Eugene makes a bit of a snarky remark of, "Well, unless you're going to pay rent, but hey, I can't think of anything better than this." And Rapunzel gets overflowed with these memories, with these quotes from other characters, particularly Frederick, Eugene, Cassandra, of the princess must be protected at all times. You're to stay here. You're never to go outside the kingdom. Yada yada. And Rapunzel says, "I love you, Eugene, and I really want to be with you, but I just need some air." So she gets out, and unbeknownst to everybody, that would be the last time, for who knows how long, that they would see the real
brunette, short-haired Rapunzel.
I think it's then that Rapunzel confides with Cassandra, like I said earlier. And I think they plan right on the spot to sneak out. But whatever. Later that night, they prepare to sneak out. Cassandra shows all the big fancy war tools that she's kept, and saying that when you're the daughter of the captain, you kind of need a hobby. You need to collect things. Of course, she's the daughter of the captain. Why wouldn't she be? And she gets into her sort of knight outfit, and gives Rapunzel a cloak to disguise her while they go sneaking out. And she leaves Pascal the chameleon behind to make sure nobody knows she's gone. They go out, and Rapunzel can't help but exclaim how excited she is about sneaking out. And Cassandra's trying to quiet her down, like, you know we're supposed to be quiet when we sneak out, right? And Cassandra has some clever techniques of sneaking around. You know, she knows the night patrols, and she knows how to get herself and Rapunzel across this moat without the guards on the bridge noticing. It's almost like Frederick was anticipating. This is just me. It's like Frederick was anticipating Rapunzel would try to sneak out of the kingdom. But I'm sure they're there purely just to protect Rapunzel in the first place. While they're sneaking out, Eugene tries to confide in Rapunzel, and Pascal makes this shadow Rapunzel from behind, using a lamplight, make it look like she's standing behind a dressing curtain, and Eugene falls for it almost the whole time. But then when he asks her, come on, say something, say anything, Pascal panics, accidentally drops the fake head, the what he was making for the shadow head figure, and Eugene has this funny moment of, great, I just poured my heart out to a frog. Alright, Pascal, where's Rapunzel? You do realize that if the king finds out that she's gone, we're all in deep, deep trouble! Eugene at first believes that Rapunzel is somewhere around the castle, and while looking around, the king catches him, but Eugene, in a very awkward way, convinces the king that she's still in her bedroom, and that she needs time to herself, and Eugene tries to apologize for the abrupt proposal, and the king's all like, we'll talk about it later, son, much later. Fathers. We have a brief scene of the king and the queen together discussing Rapunzel's future, and there is this really impactful moment where the king is just sitting at the edge of his bed, looking up and looking at the open window, the same window where Gothel had stolen Rapunzel from, had jumped out with Rapunzel when she kidnapped her all those years ago. And we hear crying in the background, we hear Frederick calling out, my daughter! Guards! Guards! Rapunzel! That's right, that's another thing. One has to wonder, if Rapunzel was her birth name, if the king and queen themselves named her Rapunzel, why didn't Gothel ever change her name so that Rapunzel herself would never connect the dots? I mean, for a long time, I guess I subconsciously assumed that Gothel had named her Rapunzel herself, which Rapunzel is supposed to be the name of a certain Germanic root flower or something. After all, the original Rapunzel fairy tale is a German fairy tale. I don't think a lot of people really notice or know that, let alone Disney. So now we're at the halfway point. We're at the halfway point of the movie. Rapunzel and Cassandra are out on the forest now. I think they're technically in the outskirts of Corona. They're not beyond the walls of Corona yet. They've, like, probably passed some villages or towns that are in Corona territory. And while they're exploring the forest, Rapunzel sings her popular song, Wind in My Hair. It's a great, great song, and probably my most favorite, or maybe my second most favorite song in the whole series. The other one I'll come back to in a later vlog.
Seems like I've spent my whole life hoping, dreaming of things I've never tried. Tangled in knots, just waiting for my time to shine.
But yeah, it's a great song of Rapunzel becoming brave and braving the world outside the walls of her home, of her new home, I suppose. And the song ends with her on the walls, preparing to explore the world beyond with Cassandra and the horses, Max and what was her name, Federa, I think. Yeah, they're going out, and she takes a rope down the wall, sliding down while singing the final line with the wind in my hair. And yeah.
And it doesn't end. And I got the wind in my hair and a song in my heart, and the fun's only starting. I got a skip in my step and I haven't a care. And everything life ought to be. I know that it's waiting for me out there, and I'll find it, I swear, with the wind in my hair.
Now we're at the halfway point, and I guess Cassandra wants to show Rapunzel something special. It's also at this point that Cassandra says, "Hey, don't tell anybody I did this, okay? Nobody can ever find out." Of course, nobody's ever gonna find out. Right. And Cassandra shows Rapunzel this section of rocks. Very large, spiky, black rocks. Rapunzel, ironically enough, says they're beautiful, asking what they are. Cassandra says, "No idea. They just sprouted up here about a year ago." And if that's the case, about a year ago, that means that they first grew there several months before anything that occurred in the film had. Interesting. And there's this small altar there with some words on it and a flower, and a picture of a flower on it. And Cassandra shows that these rocks are unbreakable when she smashes one of her own swords against one. And for some reason, she keeps the broken sword in her pouch. I don't know why. That I would think that sword is completely useless now. But anyway, apparently Cassandra also reveals that this is the same place where they where they found the flower that saved your mom and me, Rapunzel says. Okay, if that's the same location the flower's in, shouldn't it be at the edge of a hill, at the edge of a green hill or something? Why is there this big, why is there this whole section torn apart by these rocks and this gray matter and whatever? But, like, literally the moment Cassandra turns her back, Rapunzel gets closer and closer to the altar with a bunch of dust and words on it, and suddenly the rocks start glowing, and I think Rapunzel touches one of the rocks, and it begins. First, there's a bright, blinding light, and Rapunzel and Cassandra are knocked out briefly, or at least they're knocked down briefly, and Rapunzel suddenly notices there's a big chunk of blonde hair just hanging there, and suddenly one rock sprouts up. Then 1, 2, 3 rocks, then a few more rocks, and several more rocks, and then just like that, you have a whole freaking mass of rocks just coming at the ladies, and they run away. Cassandra saying, keep going, and don't look back, Rapunzel. Cassandra tries to slow down the rocks by knocking a bunch of trees down, or knocking a weak tree down, or a bunch of boulders down, or whatever, because a bunch of magical rocks that are just sprouting up literally everywhere can somehow be slowed down by the boulders. And sure enough, while Rapunzel's making her way through the forest and jumping down a hill, her magic golden hair finally returns in all its glory, and we're about 29 minutes into the movie. So we're about 55% through. It's good that they waited this long to bring the hair back, so we would get a very good enough sense of Rapunzel's new life past Gothel, past her golden hair and all that. They eventually get away from the rocks, which just stop once they get to this broken bridge, or this dilapidated bridge, I guess I should say, where the horses had stayed behind because they didn't want to get too close. And they first get back to the castle, and they try to cut Rapunzel's hair, but it's not cutting. It's just like the rocks, they're unbreakable. And this, of course, is a bit of big trouble. And they try to hide the hair when Eugene comes to check on Rapunzel again, and somehow the hair literally gets all over the place and gets woven up in all fancy ways, including one where, like, some of the hair somehow is like a chandelier holding a bunch of plants. Because somehow you can just do that with Rapunzel's hair like that. Eugene freaks the hell out while Pascal is actually really happy because this is the Rapunzel he grew up and loved. And seeing the golden hair back is absolutely awesome for him. I'm sure he's got this look up. And Eugene's freaked out, and Rapunzel thinks he's okay with her not telling him anything. But he's, of course, like, "Oh, come on, really? I thought we trusted each other, Rapunzel!" This is where Cassandra starts to become less likable, because Cassandra forces her to keep their secret from everyone, including Eugene. I mean, doesn't she know about everything that Rapunzel and Eugene went through before, long before Rapunzel ever met her? Like, but no, she cares about, if they find out what we did, I'll be taken off princess duty and we'll never see each other again. Yes, because that's clearly more important. You clearly are one for your friendship thing here. Which will be especially ironic in future episodes when it comes to feelings and all in particular, but we'll get there when we get there. I would think everybody would know what Eugene and Rapunzel went through at this point, everyone in the kingdom. Because it's not really worth keeping a secret. Especially if it leads to feelings of mistrust here in this scenario. So the queen comes by, Ariana comes by, tells Rapunzel, "Come to breakfast," and Rapunzel's like, "Oh God, what am I gonna do? My coronation is 2 hours, I gotta go to breakfast now, and we can't cut my hair. So I guess we'll just have to hide it in this really big butt wig." And Frederick, you know, he's somewhat half apologetic to Rapunzel for overprotecting her earlier, and that he's becoming more open to giving her more freedom. Because why not? But Rapunzel just shrugs it off and goes off to prepare for coronation. But there's a bit of a surprise waiting for her, because the big bad Lady Kane is preparing her minions. Oh yeah, there was this like sort of montage that was overlapping this little speech that Frederick gave about crime and danger and Corona. You see all these criminals getting rounded up like that, and including Lady Kane's right-hand man. You kind of see where this is going. They're all going to be locked up in the dungeon. And then it turns out the Duchess of Queentonia is none other than Lady Kane herself, who breaks all of her thugs out of prison and gets ready to attack, to terrorize the coronation event itself. Rapunzel, Cassandra, and Eugene go to the coronation. Rapunzel hates having to wear shoes, let alone high heels. How do people walk in these things? Before she can be crowned by the bishop or whoever it is, you hear Lady Kane in the background going, "Attention, please!" And apparently Eugene knows that voice right away. He has that look of, "Lady Kane?" So Lady Kane and her thugs are now everywhere in the throne room, including some who are dressed up as guards themselves. They stole the guards' uniforms, and they block the entryway. And they start rounding up all the royals, not just King Frederick himself, but a bunch of royals from the other kingdoms, holding them hostage and ransom. And then, this is where Lady Kane's character really falls apart for me, even now. I mean, when I first saw it, I thought it was really lame, and now I can understand better, but honestly, this character is really weak, and I would think the developers themselves must have realized that, because they rarely brought this character back after this movie. They clearly did not care about her any more than I would think that the audience would when they saw this movie. Like, what was the point of this character? Her dad, when Rapunzel was kidnapped because, like, she wanted to be kidnapped, all these thugs, all these low-life people that Frederick suspected of wrongdoing, all of them were rounded up and imprisoned unjustly. So why don't you go after him, just him? Why are you blaming Rapunzel for what happened to your dad, who apparently is still in prison or dead? They don't make that clear. If he's locked up, why doesn't she rescue him? Supposedly, if he's still locked up in Corona, unless he's somewhere outside of Corona for some reason. It's really annoying seeing that clip again where Lady Kane tells Rapunzel, "This is all your fault." And after your convenient disappearance, this happened. So, watching it again, I'm like, okay, so she suspects some sort of conspiracy where Rapunzel was deliberately taken away from the kingdom so Frederick could do all this horrible stuff. It's ridiculous, but I guess that's what happens when conspiracy theorists go too far, even if they're criminals. So, Frederick is about to be taken away, but Rapunzel it cannot stand by. She lets all her hair out, demanding them to be let go. Ariana is clearly very happy that her hair's back and Rapunzel's taking a stand. But Lady Kane doesn't really care. Haha, it's amazing what you can hide under those big wigs, huh? But then they have their big fight, and yeah, it's a pretty good fight for the most part. Though for some reason, Lady Kane fights with fans at one point. Fans, seriously? After I think Cassandra disarms her sword and whatnot, and when Rapunzel sort of pins Lady Kane down after all the other thugs are knocked out, Lady Kane's like, "You have no idea who you're dealing with." But Rapunzel, I really do like this moment where Rapunzel's like, "Believe me, I've dealt with much worse." I wish she would have said something like, "You are nothing." That really made Lady Kane feel really worthless, because she kind of is. And it was funny, because this moment makes it seem like she was going to be a supporting villain or a major villain in this show, but of course she's not, because again, she rarely appears again, and I guess she tries to escape, not realizing that there are literally a couple dozen guards on the other side trying to break into the throne room to rescue everybody. So like an idiot, she removes the block and says, I'll be back, and gets crushed by the doors. She gets arrested, and Rapunzel hugs Ariana, but Frederick is all standing there, all grouchy and mad, and then some time passes. It's nighttime now. Ah, shit, I'll have to bring that up in a sec. Frederick, you know, talks to Rapunzel, saying, "So let me get this straight. You left the kingdom without anybody knowing. Then you touched this magic rock that somehow brought your hair back and then came straight back to the kingdom." Yeah. And you were alone? Like, he suspects. He probably suspects right away that Cassandra had something to do with it. So, no big secret there. Let alone with Eugene. And Rapunzel is apologetic but says, "I'm okay. We're all okay. Everything's fine." But Frederick says, "I've got to tell you something. I love you. And when you were taken away from us 18 years ago, a part of me died. And now that you're back, now that you're finally back, I'm keeping myself promise where I swore to never let anything happen to you. And now that this is back, this hair, the very thing that took you away from me to begin with, I just don't know what to do anymore except to do what I have to do. Like, when I first saw this, I thought he meant that he was not letting Rapunzel leave the castle. But apparently he's just excessively reinforcing what he was already reinforcing before, where she can't leave the kingdom. And Rapunzel gets teary-eyed and says, "There's much more to me than you know," and leaves. I forgot to mention earlier, while she was, after she left breakfast and was hiding her hair and all, Ariana comes to comfort her and gives her her own journal. She shows a journal that her mother wrote of her own adventures in the past, and now Rapunzel has her own journal to write her own stuff in. And it has this phrase at the beginning saying, it's a French phrase saying, if I'm pronouncing it right, plus est en vous. It means there is more to you, there is more in you. Love, mother. Here, this is a bit of a nitpick, I know, but since Rapunzel was originally a German fairy tale, why couldn't the phrase have been a German phrase? Why are they using a French phrase? I guess Disney can't get enough of French things even in the late 2010s, but... So then the final scene of the film, of the opening film, interestingly enough, Cassandra's not present at all, I think. Though they make it clear early on that Cassandra does not like Eugene. You know, even though Rapunzel asserts herself, saying, "I trust Eugene." Well, I don't trust him. Again, it's like she has no idea everything Eugene and Rapunzel went through in the original film. And she insults him and says, "Oh, you're so clear on what you want, but not what she wants." Which is understandable in regards to the proposal and all. And, let's see, she interrupts. I think Rapunzel and Eugene never got to kiss until the very end, and Cassandra herself interrupted at one point. Anyway, the final scene of the movie is Rapunzel and Eugene comforting each other. Eugene saying, "Okay, I know I don't know everything that's going on, and whatever's going on with you now with the golden hair back, we'll get through it together." And he even strokes the golden hair a little, saying, "I've missed this. I've really missed this." All right. Good night, Rapunzel. Good night, Eugene. And then we have this short reprise, first of Back to Life After Happily Ever After. And the winds make the journal pages flip through, and it goes to that phrase in French, meaning there's more to you. There's more in you. Love, mother. And Rapunzel gets all confident and bright and does a reprisal of Wind in My Hair, which would become the introduction song for every episode of the show since then. And, you know, she lets that with the wind in my hair as we have a final wide shot of Corona. And I didn't notice this the first times I watched this movie, but you can actually see Rapunzel's hair flowing out in the wind from the tower of the castle. That's actually a very nice, subtle touch. The title comes in, and we have our short end credits with the short reprisal of Wind in My Hair once more. And that's the beginning of the Tangled series with Tangled Before Ever After. Okay, I've gone on for long enough. I'll do a quick wrap-up here of this film, and then move on to the first episodes and my first vlogs on those, which should be much shorter. I really like this movie. It's definitely a high 88% in my book, a very high B+. There are definitely a lot of things I wish they had done better. I wish they had worked with the trust between Eugene and Rapunzel more. I don't really understand why they had to force this whole BFF thing with a character that we barely know yet. And it would become much more clear to us in future episodes that Rapunzel and Cassandra were becoming really close. over the months that they knew each other, especially since, you know, you got, after having nobody but your mother as your best friend, you kind of need another girl to hang out with after all those years in the tower. Again, Lady Kane is a very weak villain, and I'm pretty glad they didn't use her much anymore after this movie. I don't know, I'm not sure what they could have done to make her more interesting. I guess they kind of did what they had to do, but maybe they could have just made it where she just wanted to get rich or just wanted to take out the royals just because, you know, maybe that would have made her that much more effective of a villain, let alone all these guys in her posse or whatever that were helping her with this scheme. I love Mandy Moore's performance and Zachary Levi's and Eden Espinosa as Cassandra, I believe. I love that Clancy Brown is Frederick, and Julie Bowen, if I'm saying that right, from Modern Family, who's voicing Ariana, she's great. Yeah, the voice acting is pretty damn good overall. We definitely could have had a bit more of Rapunzel's new life before she got her blonde hair back, especially since the short brunette-haired Rapunzel is the true Rapunzel, and all of a sudden we got the long blonde famous Rapunzel back. It kind of shocks me that Rapunzel is not more angry that she has her hair back, because it was this hair that resembled Gothel's power over her for so many years. You know, I would think that at first she would hate having it back. She would absolutely hate having it back, but I don't know. The action could have been a bit better, definitely, even for a kid's show. I mean, there are definitely kid's shows that have much lamer choreography with their action sequences, even in animated series. But that was definitely not the case here. It was pretty solid here. I would not add much more to the second half of the film than was already there. If this had been a full hour and a half long film, then everything that happened in the second half here definitely could have fit in the last half hour of said hour and a half long film, or maybe hour 15 minutes. This definitely felt like 2.5-3 episodes altogether. And I don't really like how it's considered a Disney Channel original movie, when it's clearly, when it's very much connected to a Disney feature film. And who knows, if they had enough of a budget, they probably could have made this a 3D series, a full-on 3D series. And I'm hoping to see, like, 3D recreational images of the best moments from this show, let alone this movie. But, you know, I don't think I need to go on much more here. This was a pretty dang good film. Nowhere as great as the film, let alone certain episodes of the series, which actually were a lot better than this movie alone. But I've shared my piece. Thank you very much for sharing this time with me. I will be working on some of the other episodes and vlogs as soon as I'm done wrapping this up, and I'll do my best to be as concise with the episodes as opposed to this film. But you know, I just wanted to summarize the plot as best I could with this film as compared with the episodes, which are much more simpler to explain in a broad sense, I suppose. But yeah, thanks very much again. I am the Spearman, the Embracer of Human Good, and Analyst of Fiction, and I'm definitely looking forward to seeing you guys in the next Tangled Vlogs. Take care, everybody.